We are looking for love in all the wrong places. We are looking to bits and pieces of the creation to satisfy a longing that can only find rest in the Creator. We frenetically latch on to the next promotion, the next toy, the next one-night stand, the next marriage even, with the misplaced hope that finally, this time, it will work and we'll know peace. But it never does. Our rest lies not in acquiring, but in being found. Nothing created can return our love. Nothing made can truly make us happy. It was not until Augustine was taken up in the very life of God that he finally found the rest that he was looking for. Now his longings found their end not in the circumstances or fleeting praise of others, but in the only one who could never pass away. And this reorientation of his very identity came with a kind of unexpected bonus, you might say. Once he found the end of his loves in the Creator, the entirety of creation itself sort of comes back to him and could be received as the gift that it was. So instead of seizing upon the creation as an end in itself to try to satisfy this longing and hunger, clinging to the penultimate as if it were ultimate, Augustine's longings found their rest in the Creator who gives every good and perfect thing. Loving God, then, is not a recipe for hating or escaping the world. It's a way of getting the world back again as creation, as gift. Now, Augustine narrates this in his Confessions, which is, as you know, a kind of ancient memoir that I think is just begging to be a screenplay. I don't know how this hasn't made it to the silver screen, because it is compelling stuff. Organized around the parable of the prodigal son, Augustine tells that parable as also the story of humanity, leaving home, spending the gifts from the father, to the point of nothingness, loving good things in the wrong way, until finally he hits rock bottom and he realizes, I am not myself. You have to realize that the structure of the Confessions has this kind of circular model where it begins with a sense of, I'm made to be at home with the Father, but like the prodigal son, the son comes to the Father and says, I want your stuff. I want your gifts without you. And the Father gives them, and he journeys away. It's a movement of exit, of departure, of exile, you might even say, and eventually spends every good gift to the point that he finds himself in nothingness in a distant country, and he is not himself. And at that moment, we see the road back and the Father already waiting expectantly at the end of the lane. So Augustine is telling his story because in his analysis, it's also the human story. And it's not just another trite religious tract, a tidy just-so story with a happy ending. This isn't Amish fiction when you're reading Augustine's Confessions. If anything, the early Augustine reads more like the Wolf of Wall Street, with, I think, sometimes shades of Joey Berglund in Jonathan Franzen's novel Freedom. Because to quell his restlessness, Augustine tried almost all of the strategies of distraction that our own age has to offer. Education was going to be his path out of the provinces, a way for a social climber to clamber into the cultural elite and centers of power. Escaping the clutches of a cloying religious mother, he set sail for the center of cultural production and power in Rome, and ultimately lands in Milan. And you have to feel the sort of parallels here. Imagine that Milan is his Manhattan. Milan is his Washington, D.C. This is the center of power that he's trying to get to. Along the way, he develops what we might call a taste for flesh, so to speak, and becomes ravenous in his pursuit of sexual pleasure. He revels in academic dispute, rhetorical swagger, literary prowess. He loves being part of the literary in-crowd. Augustine and his crew are hosting the Paris Review parties of his day. He's living the dream in many ways. And yet, something is amiss, and something is missing. Augustine is not himself. He says, as he puts it in Chadwick's translation, I became to myself a region of destitution. I became to myself a region of destitution. There's something about the nature of the human person that craves what Charles Taylor calls simply fullness. This experience of life as being capable of something fuller, higher, more genuine, more authentic, more intense. We can't not crave this, but only God, our Creator, can truly satisfy it. So when this is kind of the entire discography of U2. I know you guys are too young to appreciate U2, but Joshua Tree is the best album that's ever been produced, just for the record, and it's all about this dynamic. There we go. Can I get an amen? So when the creature departs from God, trying to satisfy this craving in anything but God, immersing himself in the material world as if that's all there is, what happens is that creature effectively loses his or her own identity. He's left a part of himself behind. And so at the height of his success, so to speak, Augustine realizes that he's dying for a taste of this fullness. And he analyzes his angst in terms of fragmentation, dislocation, and being pulled apart. So if you reread the Confessions again with this kind of highlighter, watch for all the places where Augustine uses the language of fragmentation, tearing, distending, being pulled apart. Because what's happening is he's losing his identity. He's losing his selfhood as he journeys further and further away from home. And I use the term angst here advisedly, precisely because of the restlessness that Augustine is describing in the very opening chapter of the Confessions is going to be exactly the source for Martin Heidegger in the early 20th century to start talking about angst. That's the direct influence. Now, for a while, Augustine fools himself. He talks himself into believing that the disappointments and depression and nagging dis-ease are actually delights, like we can all do. A brilliant psychologist millennia ahead of Freud, Augustine probes all the ways that we deflect and project, the myriad ways we talk ourselves into believing that moral expectations are repressive, while actually repressing what we refuse to see, namely that what we think of as freedom is eating us alive. As Augustine puts it in book 3 of the Confessions, I was glad to be in bondage. I was glad to be in bondage, he remarks in retrospect. But eventually, what felt like freedom when Augustine was fleeing the backwoods of the Gast and the clutches of his mother actually starts to feel like a trap. And he continues in book 3 and puts it this way, the liberty I loved was merely that of a runaway. The liberty, right, the kind of liberty I loved was merely that of a runaway. To give you a contemporary illustration of this, Deanna and I recently rewatched, did we watch it together or did I watch this on a plane? Up in the Air. How many of you have ever seen the George Clooney movie Up in the Air? If you haven't, it's not a big deal. Let me try to rehearse it for you. So this sad kind of liberty of the runaway is illustrated in this film, Up in the Air. It began as a novel by Walter Kern, by the way, which is also fantastic. Here's the story. Ryan Bingham, played by the gorgeous George Clooney, Ryan Bingham has shed all of his attachments. He's like a consultant who helps companies fire people. He spends all of his time going from city to city helping companies offload people. He lives on airplanes and is in fact at home in airports. His quest isn't a destination, but it's actually just incessant journeying. He wants his goal is to be a million miler. He wants to be a million miler. In fact, he has made a career of telling people to shed everything that would hold them down. And so now he's also a motivational speaker with this gimmicky prop.
a backpack that he sets on the table, which is to represent all the things that weigh us down, especially, he'll say, relationships. And if you want to be, his shtick at these motivational talks is, if you really want to be successful, see all the stuff in this backpack, your property, your relationships above all, you need to slough off that backpack, because then you'll be free. Then you'll have achieved a success. Then you'll have independence. Bingham counsels up in the air independence. But when his assistant finally challenges him, his assistant is that she was in Pitch Perfect, the Anna Kendrick, thank you. Anna Kendrick is this great character who kind of challenges him. She's like the Augustinian moment in the film, in a way. And she challenges him, and in fact asks the perfect Augustinian question. What do you want? I'm all over this, right? What do you want, she says to Ryan Bingham. And his answer is silence. You don't even know what you want, she says. And when he finally achieves near the end of the film, this sought after million miler status, he's on the plane and they announce that he's achieved his million miles, and the captain comes to visit him and congratulates him. We appreciate your loyalty, the captain says. And then he asks, so where are you from? I'm from here, is his answer. He's from nowhere. He doesn't even know who he is. The hollowness of his own answer rings in his own ears. That's the freedom of a runaway who doesn't know who they are. Augustine tries that. It doesn't work. He realizes that he's lost himself. So Augustine starts looking for something to belong to some cause. By the way, it's really interesting. If you go back to the parable of the prodigal son, there's a key moment. Is it Luke 15, I think, is the parable of the prodigal son? Thank you. I knew Wheaton College students would know the answer to this question. And there's a key moment in the prodigal son where he has this experience. The Greek, I think, is literally he comes to himself. It's this sort of wake-up call moment in which he remembers who he is, and he looks around. It's like, what am I doing here? Augustine has that experience too. Do you know what it was? Reading philosophy. His first wake-up call. Augustine doesn't have one conversion. Augustine has either many conversions or a really, really long conversion that takes books 5 to 8. Right? And there's this unfolding, and the beginning of it is when he reads Cicero's Hortensius, which is an exhortation to lead an examined life. The book, he says, changed my feelings. It gave me different values and priorities. Suddenly, he says, every vain hope became empty to me. That's his wake-up call. Now he's starting the journey of return. The pleasures and pursuits that had been everything are now tainted with a kind of nothingness. He has no idea where he's going yet, but he can't go back to who and where he was. I think Augustine is a masterful diagnostician. He masterfully diagnoses the self-alienation that characterizes our own age. But he offers a radically different prescription, one that might almost seem implausible now, but one that I think is going to become more and more thinkable and entertainable as the claustrophobic worlds of late modern culture yield diminishing returns. The perceived pleasures of sexual experimentation, the knowing confidence of ironic distance, the perennial false promises of wealth accumulation, those and 100 other gods will fail to return the love our hearts are made for. And while the popularity of something like Lena Dunham's Girls might seem to indicate a culture that has reached the very apogee of disordered love, I wonder if we can't already see signs of what we might call a productive disappointment, a longing for something more than the endless chase of consumption, comfort, and self-actualization. The disenchantment of our secular age is not the last word. And that's why I think we actually might be entering a season in which we are ripe to hear a story like Augustine's again. You see, Augustine tried the alternatives. He spent the first 30 years of his life looking for love in all the wrong places. He tried to find satisfaction in what's fleeting, to worship what would pass away, to invest the stuff of creation as if it could have the immortality of the Creator. But all of that would disappoint. Like when he reflects on the heartbreaking death of one of his best friends in book 4. I had poured out my soul on the sand by loving a person sure to die as if he would never die. It's the most heartrending scene, I think, in the Confessions. I had, he says, loved what I loved as a substitute for you. Perhaps we will never get to the bottom of our dis-ease and angst until we are willing to look at it through the lens of worship and to see our pursuits as idolatries. Should we be surprised then that a writer like David Foster Wallace entertains just this hypothesis in his famous Kenyon College commencement address? In a very Augustinian spirit, Wallace reframes our own malaise as a matter of worship. Listen, so remember, this is the non-Christian David Foster Wallace speaking to the probably quite decidedly non-Christian graduating class of Kenyon College, and he says this. In the day-to-day trenches of adult life, there is actually no such thing as atheism. There is no such thing as not worshiping. Everybody worships. The only choice we get is what to worship. And the compelling reason for maybe choosing some sort of God or spiritual type things to worship, be it JC or Allah, be it Yahweh or the Wiccan Mother Goddess or the Four Noble Truths, this is Wallace, I'm not endorsing this, okay? Is that the reason is because that pretty much anything else you worship will eat you alive. That was what Augustine realized that all of his disordered loves and pursuits were actually worshiping other things that were starting to eat him alive. So perhaps we're now primed to hear Augustine's analysis anew. Its very ancientness and strangeness and transcendence functioning as a kind of jolt to our modern naturalized sensibilities. Perhaps Augustine could be the wake-up call for a 21st century investment banker in the way that Cicero was a wake-up call for that social striver prowling Milan in the 4th century. However, I don't mean to suggest that Augustine's work only has a kind of apologetic force about it. He speaks, I think, in many ways even more loudly to people of faith. As a penetrating psychologist, he has this enduring insight into the persistence of temptations that continue to alienate us from ourselves. It shouldn't be lost on us, right, that the author of the Confessions is writing as a bishop. The guy who's writing the Confessions is a bishop. And he is more than willing to actually give us a peek behind the curtain of his own consciousness. My favorite account is, this is in book 10, my favorite account is his own addressing of ambition and pride. With respect to, when it comes to ambition, he says, in this matter, I have almost no capacity for self-exploration. That's a pretty big, like imagine your pastor comes to you and says, you know what? I am horrible at recognizing my own sinful failures with respect to ambition. That's what Augustine the bishop is doing, right? He's sort of owning his own struggles in this regard. And he says, pride and ambition are sly tempters, easily parading as angels of light. Because the point is, how can we live indifferent to the praise of others? If we perform our calling well, we receive praise. When we receive praise, we're tempted to think really well of ourselves and then be involved in sort of self-consideration and self-concern, and then we start doing it for that. So should we be negligent precisely in order to avoid the temptation of praise? I mean, if you deal with basically problems of vainglory, one way to maybe avoid that temptation is to just be terrible, you know, to not do anything that warrants moral praise. Is that a solution? No, hardly. But one can see how Augustine's very project of writing the Confessions themselves totters on the cusp of this tension, right? Why are you really writing the Confessions, Augustine? Who's this about? What's this for? And the great thing is Augustine would totally own that and say, I have no pretensions to purity here. In fact, I'm going to include in my story my own account that I am sure part of me is doing this to show off, to get your attention, to get your praise. I would also say that Augustine is a remarkable exegete of cultural liturgies that beset us. The rites and rituals of ambition, consumption, privilege, that aren't just things that we do, but do things to us. The frat house, the football stadium, the rituals of Wall Street finance. These are quasi-religious sites in late modern culture, not because they purvey a message, but because they're incubators of love that are rife with rituals that train and direct our hearts and our desires. And conversion is no magical panacea for that. Belief doesn't inoculate our loves from their immersion in those cultural liturgies. So we need to constantly take stock of the formation of our loves and longings, all the subtle ways that secular liturgies bend our desires towards earth rather than heaven. And this is where, I won't spend much time on this, but I also think this is where Augustine's political thought would be very, but I've resolved to just not talk about politics in 2016 because it's a disastrous year to talk about any of this. Now, finally, Augustine in France, we get to this theme. I think Augustine is ripe for the kind of postmodern retrieval I'm suggesting, precisely because there are aspects of his own vision and method that resonate with and have shaped postmodern sensibilities. First, Augustine frames the most fundamental existential questions in terms of love and longing, not knowledge and information. In other words, for Augustine, the root cause of my self-alienation and angsty restlessness is not primarily or only a lack of intellectual knowledge. It's not that some bit of knowledge is missing from my cognitive map. If that were the case, I could Google, read, or think my way out of my malaise. By the way, if that was also the case, it would mean that Augustine is a Christian by book 7. But he's not. No, for Augustine, my selfhood and wholeness are matters of disordered affections. So he doesn't write, "My mind is puzzled until it knows you," but rather, "My heart is restless until it rests in you." The site of our malaise, and equally the site of our redemption, is the arena of our affections and our longings. And Augustine, interestingly, he appeals to us on that same register, which points to the second aspect of his kind of inherent postmodern relevance. In the Confessions, Augustine doesn't so much lay out an argument as invite us into a story. Now, within that overarching story, he makes arguments, and he's going to convince you of things. But the sweep of the project is narratival. When, in the end of the 19th century, Pope Leo XIII led a revival of Thomas Aquinas's intellectual architectonics, that was probably exactly the right thing to do at that moment. But I wonder if the challenges of our emergent 21st century call for an Augustinian renaissance that addresses what Rusty Reno has called the empire of desire, that is, the modern world. Augustine doesn't give us so much a catalog of answers as he paints the picture of a character on a quest. And so his biographer, again, Peter Brown, rightly suggests that we see Augustine as a kind of romantic. Brown puts it this way. If to be a romantic, by the way, I'm not talking like Hallmark romantic, but like the romantics as a literary and philosophical movement. If to be a romantic means to be a man acutely aware of being caught in an existence that denies him the fullness for which he craves, to feel that he is defined by his tension towards something else, by his capacity for faith, for hope, for longing, to think of himself as a wanderer seeking a country that is always distant, but made ever present to him by the quality of love that groans for it, well then, Augustine is definitely a romantic. And I'm suggesting that there is yet a third reason why Augustine might be considered the patron saint of our postmodern age. If we can read him as our contemporary, it's in part because we are actually the unwitting heirs of his influence across the 20th century. If ours is, as Taylor has said, an age of authenticity, this is in no small part because of the ripple effect of existentialism in the 20th century. The search for significance, the quest to find oneself, the Hollywood storyline that celebrates a protagonist's resolute decision to follow his dreams rather than conform to expectations. These are all the pop cultural echoes of Martin Heidegger, Jean-Paul Sartre, Albert Camus, Jacques Derrida, and others. But interestingly, the genealogy of that existentialist strain of 20th century philosophy is directly Augustinian. In important ways, Heidegger's Being in Time, which is this 1928 text that sort of landed as a bombshell on early contemporary continental philosophy, that text, that as it arrived in 1928, has a backstory. Heidegger's analysis of our pathetic derivative conformity to the chattering of what he calls the crowd, coupled with his call for a resolute choice of a project that summons us to authenticity, well, these turn out to be Heidegger's translations of Augustine into the language of phenomenology. While Being in Time seemed to kind of drop from the sky in 1927, in the 1990s, as they were publishing Heidegger's earlier pre-Being in Time lectures, we started to see the sources for where all of these ideas come from. And it turns out that one of the primary sources for Augustine's thought was a 1919 to 1923 lecture course that he kept giving on St. Augustine's Confessions. And when you go back and read this early 1920 lecture on Augustine's Confessions, you start to see the emergence of all of the categories that are going to be enshrined in Being in Time in 1927 and 28 that then influence the rest of the 20th century, including people like Sartre. And so what happens is that means that there's an Augustinian rock dropped into the philosophical pond that keeps rippling across the 20th century and into the 21st. The point, if I can tweak Faulkner just a bit, is that Augustine isn't dead, he isn't even past. We don't need to engage in some sort of acrobatics of relevance to cultivate interest in a 5th century North African bishop, because in a sense, he's been with us the whole time. He just went underground. He's part of our cultural subconscious. And if you dig below the surface, you start to see him everywhere. You start to notice, for example, that Hannah Arendt did her dissertation on St. Augustine and love under the direction of Karl Jaspers and the tutelage of Martin Heidegger. Or that a fellow North African and existentialist, Albert Camus, also wrote a dissertation on Augustine and Neoplatonism before he started writing The Fall, The Plague, and The Stranger. Once when I was in Paris not too long ago, I stepped out of the university onto La Place de la Sorbonne. I was headed for the PUF store, which is sadly no longer there, but I stopped short in front of a smaller bookstore, which is just across the street, the equally famous J. Vrin store. And there, in the middle of 21st century France's intellectual center, outside of the Sorbonne, was an entire display window devoted to St. Augustine on the left bank. There, beside the hallowed halls of the Sorbonne in the land of liberté, égalité, and fraternité, and deconstruction, was a celebration of philosophical works, both ancient and contemporary, devoted to a Catholic bishop from the African provinces. But I shouldn't have been surprised. In fact, in the mid-20th century, interest in Augustine was renewed by French intellectuals Interest in Augustine was renewed by French intellectuals, particularly those from colonial Africa. The Algerians Jacques Derrida and Jean-François Lyotard, to whom we should add the Algerian Albert Camus. And since then, Sorbonne professor Jean-Luc Marion has published his own book on Augustine. So we don't need to make Augustine postmodern. In a way, the postmodern is already Augustinian in some sense. Augustine's own story suggests this structure that resonates with our contemporary context. In a way, I think we could read it as a travelogue of the heart. And what's interesting is that structure of exile and return is a structure that left its mark on someone like Camus, whose earliest writing project was his dissertation on Augustine. Throughout the rest of his career, in both his essays and his fiction, you see, watch again, read Camus now with this highlighter, and you'll constantly see this theme of exile and kingdom title of one of his collections of stories, of departure and longed for homecoming. Somebody has said that Camus is our most Augustinian atheist, that he's haunted by this sort of Augustinian structure. Sorry, I feel like I'm talking a long time. 2 minutes. While Virgil's Aeneid haunts the confessions, the more direct structuring trope is, as I've said, the parable of the prodigal son, who runs off with his premature inheritance, having effectively told his father, "I wish you were dead." One of the cultural things you have to remember in the context of the parable of the prodigal son is when a son comes to the father and says, "I want the inheritance now," when do you usually get an inheritance? When the father dies. So to come to the father and say, "I want my inheritance now," is effectively saying to the father, "I wish you were dead." And this odd, surprising father does what? He acquiesces. "Here you go," he says. "I love you." So the son takes his father's property. The Greek word, by the way, for property in this passage is ousia. So philosophers, you should be geeking out right now, because ousia is our word for being or substance, all right? So the son takes the father's being, ousia, and departs for a distant country, squandering it in dissolute living and ending up with, he basically goes to Vegas, and ends up with nothing and in nothingness. How could Augustine resist reading this as a parable of human existence itself? Being, ousia, is gifted to us by our creator, but we take that gift as if there were no giver, and we set off to so-called live according to our best lights. And what's the result? You, a good Jewish boy, wake up one morning and realize that pigs are eating better than you are. And you start to ask yourself some questions, like, what the heck am I doing? And who am I? And whose am I? So despondent you can't even voice it, you nonetheless start to wonder timidly, desperately, "I wonder if my father would take me back." And by some grace inexplicable, you start on your way back home, and you're yet again rehearsing this long speech that's in 3 parts apology and 2 parts legal plea for reinstatement, and you're bowled over when that father gathers you up in your arms while your head is down, and your mother later tells you he walked to the end of the road every single day waiting for you. That's Augustine's story, the visible skeleton of the confessions. That literary and theological frame of Augustine's story finds a parallel in his own experiences. But what interests me in this deeply human drama of self-imposed exile, a hunger for home, the malaise of distant countries we drive ourselves to, that drama, that framework, that analysis of the existential condition, human condition, that spurred 20th century continental philosophers. These biblical tropes and Christian themes have made a dent on the existential environment in ways that we haven't realized. But we must read them the same way Augustine read Plato. Do you remember in book 7? It's so great to be in this place where, like, everybody has read the Confessions. Do you remember in book 7 where Augustine is talking about how important it was reading Plato and what a sort of how many lights went on and solved so many intellectual problems for him? But then he, at every point, he makes this move. This is what I read in Plato, but this is what I didn't see. Here's what I found in Plato, but here's what was still missing. That's how now we need to read these 20th century inheritances of Augustine himself. Looking for the points of contact, yes, and the debts, but also attentive to what's missing. And in this respect, the absence is in many ways the same. Our philosophical inheritances continue to neglect the radical grace of the incarnation. In Heidegger, in Camus, in Derrida, in Lyotard, we get an Augustinianism without grace, which of course is not Augustine at all. It's as if only half of Augustine's corpus made it the journey into 20th century France. In this existential tradition from Germany and France, we get a philosophical appropriation of Augustine's account of the human condition, a trenchant account in many ways of disordered loves, and we get insight into the tragedy of fallenness, But conspicuous by its absence is any good news. Remy Brog has recently remarked about Camus' application. What Remy Brog has recently said about Camus could also be said of Heidegger and Derrida. Brog puts it this way: Camus is reasonably well informed about Christianity, understood as a Christian metaphysics. But perhaps he strangely neglected to pause a little longer over the person from which the adjective Christian derives its meaning. Here, too, perhaps, for us, is the enduring scandal of the Christ, the stumbling block that is any word that challenges our autonomy and independence. So contrary to Heidegger and the existentialist, my resolve, my choosing, my project can never achieve the gift of grace. The good news of grace is also a word that I am not my own, that in a relation of dependence, I try and find true freedom, that I will be liberated to be myself only when I take on the light yoke of the God-man who took on my humanity and bore my sin. The task, I think, of a distinctly Christian philosophy today is to inherit the whole Augustine. An Augustine whose heart is aflame, renewed by the Spirit, gifted by grace, at home with the Father, and to invite our neighbors to see that this is how we learn to be human. Thanks very much. So, what would you like to talk about? Comments, questions, criticisms, worries? I think we would like folks to step to the mic because they're recording it. Who's first? Euler? We wore them out. Yes, sir.
Thanks, Dr. Smith.
Sure.
Thanks for confirming what I often tell my students, which is that everything interesting in philosophy already happened by the end of the Middle Ages.
That's right.
I really appreciate that.
We're just trying to catch up.
I had a question about Augustine's famous phrase, which you recited, that our hearts are restless until they rest in thee.
Yeah.
And particularly about that resting in thee bit. You mentioned one of the things that reminded you of the postmoderns in Augustine was that for him, the focus is on love and longing and so forth, as opposed to like knowledge and data and stuff like that. But as far as I know, the rest that he's talking about there is really a sort of intellectual beholding of God that we're ultimately aimed at. That's what we really want. We don't want hearts aflamed. We don't want desire and feeling and turbulence anymore. We want to just see God in this kind of heady intellectual way. How do you reconcile those?
Yeah, I mean, we'd have to have a discussion about that. That feels a bit to me like a retroactive reading of a particular take on the beatific vision back to Augustine, and I'm not denying that something like that isn't there, but you could also get, like, that could become a really thick and perhaps slightly anachronistic hermeneutic for reading Augustine. So I think that's there. I think if you, and certainly in Book 9, the vision with Monica in Ostia is that sort of, I think it's Augustine that is most Neoplatonic as well. And so I don't deny that those themes are there. I think there's an interesting trajectory then if you watch the development of Augustine's thought across his corpus up through to City of God and also some of the later sermons where, but I think you can already see it in the Confessions too, right? Where there is a certain kind of intellectual achievement that has to take place for him to be in a place to be able to rest. But then if you look at the actual sort of garden scene of conversion itself, it's more a matter of will, it seems to me, than intellect. Does that seem fair? And something happens on the register of the will there, which is bound up with this resting theme. However, I'm not telling you anything you don't know, so we're just having a conversation. The other theme, I always think it's really, really important to see the kind of lexical synonym universe, right? So when Augustine's thinking about rest, it is peace. It's also, for him, though, enjoyment. It seems to me that enjoyment and rest work synonymously for him in a way. And what is enjoyment is precisely your love finding its end in what it was made for, right? So there's a kind of delight that characterizes it. So that's the happy life, right? The happy life is when you finally learn to love what you were made to love. And I guess maybe I'm leaning more on that use-enjoyment hermeneutic to think about that, and I'm less... it could be because of like Protestant Neoplatonic hangups that I'm less inclined to that other. But you're totally right. They're both there. It's a great question. Great question. Other themes.
Thank you, Dr. Smith. So I have a question about dealing with people in contexts where they don't realize they have the longing. So I think you touch on it in the beginning of how not to be secular, like you go out and realize that your neighbors aren't even asking the question.
Yeah, yeah.
And so me and my friend, we always talk about working in a secular context, and that's the feel.
Yeah.
Like it's like the prodigal son before he realizes he has to come home,
yeah.
Like before he gets to the pigs.
Yeah.
And that seems to be the context
yeah.
we're dealing with. Not
yes.
So it's not like we can just rush in and say, hey, no. You know that longing you have?
Yes.
Augustine
yes.
talks about
yes.
it.
Yes.
So.
Yeah, no, it's a great question. And it's a great question because I don't have an answer. But that itself is, because I think actually in that space, what we want is the strategy or method to push people to that realization, even if it's a realization of lack, right, or a realization of emptiness. And tell me what you think if I say, I'm waiting for another shoe to drop here, but I'm not sure that I can engineer people into that space, right? I mean, on the other hand, what you might hope for is modeling ways of life that bear witness to a fullness, a transcendence, a significance, that when people look at it contrastively, they're like, oh, I don't have any of that sort of going on. But I think part of what worries me, but I think what maybe frustrates others is I don't think you can come up with the argument that makes people reach the conclusion that they have loss, right? It has to be this vibe that, there might be seasons, right, where you have to sort of just be present and alongside it, waiting for that to happen. It's a terrible answer to what is a really, really good question, but I think the reason I have a terrible answer is because I'm not sure that there is an answer other than this kind of contrastive method. Great point, though. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. First of all, is it okay if I ask questions from up there? Is that one
yeah,
on?
Yeah, absolutely.
Like
totally. Yeah. Yeah. Come on. Yeah. Let's make sure
now.
This one's right. I like
Yay.
This better. Yes. Great.
Okay.
Great.
So
thank you.
My experience of the confessions is that it works because it is a spiritual journey as well as like an intellectual and academic
yes.
journey.
And I love that you just said, by the way, as well as, right? It's
yes.
both of these things at
oh,
the same time.
Absolutely. And as you move through it, it interacts with details in your own life, and and like it's autobiographical in the sense that it's Augustine's life, but it's also connects deeply with our own journeys,
totally.
And it's designed to take us through that a spiritual journey. And I'm wondering if you think that its success comes from taking us through Augustine's spiritual journey or taking us through our own spiritual journey, in the sense that do we need to have stuff as that it's part of our biographies that relates to Augustine in order to arrive at those same conclusions. So for the philosophers who have like half of that story of Augustine and kind of have that like partial canon
yeah.
of Augustine,
yeah.
But not the whole one, is it possibly because their own biographies were in some ways incomplete?
So don't leave.
Okay.
That's a great question. Does everybody understand the question? So in other words, does reading Augustine work if you're like him?
Yeah.
In some ways, right? And
yeah.
which might also be like him in like all the like really horrible, terrible.
Yes.
Augustine was basically a frat boy, right?
Yeah.
And so that's a great, I want to say no. I mean, Augustine himself in book 10, his account, because he struggles with like, why am I telling my story publicly, right? Because
mm-hmm.
really, remember, the whole thing is narrated as a prayer. So you would think of this as a pretty private encounter, but he's obviously letting all of us in on it. Mm-hmm. And I don't think it's because Augustine sees himself as exemplary because of his achievements, but rather that he sees it's exemplary only in the sense that he thinks that this is characteristic of the human condition. So I think he thinks that the specifics could be different, mm-hmm. but the general existential drama of the soul that's left home and left itself and left the Father and needs to come home is something that should have resonance beyond that. Now, the philosophical piece, I do think Augustine wants every Christian to seek wisdom. Mm-hmm. So it's not like a discipline, a professional discipline, as much as getting on that journey and being on that path, right? Does that help?
Yeah, I guess, like, the wandering and the feelings of restlessness might be universal, but there's a certain path in his life where he actually left.
Yes.
And then,
yes.
Yeah. Oh, and then finds return. Like, do you need a path that's similar
yes.
to that and have the return piece?
I don't think so. Because, okay. And again, it's interesting. If you next time you go through the Confessions, see, I'm just assuming you read it, you know, every month.
well,
the next time you go through the Confessions, watch. There are very, very key pieces where he says the journey I'm talking about is not geographical. It's an existential journey. And I think what's crucial is, so books 1 to 9 are kind of his past, right? Mm-hmm. And then book 10, he's writing about his present. And what's interesting is how, and now he's a bishop who's preaching and baptizing mm-hmm. people, and he still is owning up to how much he's still prone to wander, mm-hmm. right? And needs to be called back. And I think precisely because he can, in the midst of his Christian life, still sort of diagnose this departure and return, you know, the prone to wander and exile himself dynamic, and that he needs to keep working through that, so that you could be somebody who grew up and who just had the most blessed Christian formation at home, mm-hmm. and it, you know, you didn't go to Vegas, and you weren't a frat boy, and you didn't have it. You've just actually been following Jesus your whole life, and yet Augustine is probing so deep, piercing the marrow, mm-hmm. to make you own up to your own exiles and returns. Right? I think that's mm-hmm. why there's something. I don't want to. I'm not saying that Augustine's not the Bible. I mean, it's no. Never mind. Augustine's not the Bible, but. So I don't want to claim universality, but I do think it is remarkable if you look at people who've been influenced by the Confessions across history. It's certainly had wide purchase for them, it seems to me. Yeah, okay. That's a great question.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Sir.
Your, not depiction, but telling the story like as the prodigal son kind of sounded a little bit like a descent into non-being and back almost.
Yeah.
And so it just kind of triggered a question of, how does Augustine's story, both in the Confessions and his experience, this is a 1.5 part question.
Okay. We'll allow it. 2 part, no, but go ahead.
How does it frame the way that we should talk about that kind of state of non-being, like of talk about and
yeah.
engage the non-being, the evil in the world, and then kind of on the the other side of that, how does cultural liturgy or like, How is it forming us into being or non-being?
Yeah. That's a great question. So I think the non-being thing is, right, a really, really tricky category at this point, because the descent into nothingness is, he's naming this kind of existential way of being, not whether or not you are being. Do you know what I mean? Because you know that for Augustine, non-being would be non-existence, obviously, right? So even the fallen soul never is actually dissolved to nothingness. It's disordered by its attachment to the lower things and so on and so forth. So for Augustine then, evil, do you all talk about this here? For Augustine, not even the devil is purely evil, right? Because insofar as the devil still exists, he still bears something of the good order of creation itself, but his will and desires and ends are so disordered, right, that it's like as evil as you can get. But even then, it doesn't cease to exist. So I think in that sense, being, right, coming home to oneself is really about how to be, and not whether to be, right? It's the mode by which I now orient my being and my existence towards God and his kingdom. That's why there's this teleological element about it. And that's where the liturgies piece comes in, right? For Augustine, one of the things I'm a big advocate of is you will never understand Augustine if you only read the quote-unquote philosophical works or the theological works. You have to read the sermons and you have to read his letters. And when you read his sermons, remember, Augustine's a pastor, he's a bishop. And when you start to see the role that the sacraments, right, the practices of the body of Christ play in retraining my being, then you start to realize that that's where, in a sense, liturgy is how you learn to be human again, to sort of to connect back to chapel this morning. Yeah, great question. Thank you. I do that my whole life, is making the mic lower.
So I have a bit of a confession. It's actually been a couple of years since I've read the Confessions.
Yes,
so
I understand.
You've been motivating me to go back and reread them. Excuse me. But more recently, I have been reading Bonhoeffer's Cost of Discipleship.
Yeah.
And so a lot of the things that you were talking about sort of the daily liturgies, really reminded me of that. And so my question is, as young Christians entering into the church and into the Christian community, whether as leaders in the church or just as lay people, what advice would you give for us going forward as we kind of combat this age of cheap grace?
Yeah.
And as we try to lead back the church to the, to costly grace and to liturgies that are shaping the church to be more like Christ?
Whew, that's a big question. So the two things that come to mind, and I'm trying to be like really concrete. The first is committing to real, lived, multi-generational, local congregations of the body of Christ. Right? So, and every piece of what I just said there is an important qualifier, right? Because I think sometimes we were talking about this earlier. Sometimes Christian colleges can kind of ruin you for the church, right? Because you have this kind of like idyllic experience of Christian community that, by the way, you're never going to have again, okay? But if you appropriately see all of the incredible channels of grace that are at work in just that humble congregation that's on the corner, and to realize that those are places where Christ has made a promise to be present and shape you, I think that's unbelievably powerful. And it's not a big sexy thing, but it's like a very, very foundational thing. The other thing is, and this is where, I mean, you are all so gifted and brilliant and can shoot for the stars, so you can kind of do whatever you want. In the midst of that, I would encourage you to consider place and a commitment to place. I don't know what, I'm not saying that means you can't ever move. All I'm saying is, don't underestimate the formative power of like finding that a congregation and community like that, and then actually saying, for the sake of my formation in Christ and bearing witness to the coming kingdom, I need a season of being placed and present and proximate to others, that which will mean sometimes giving up on opportunities. Like, you'll miss out on some things. But I think in the end, there's a kind of liberation that comes from it. I think a lot of the malaise that we experience today is this frenetic pursuit of what's the next best thing. And I think we lose ourselves in that kind of... It's a defragmentation commitment. Do those make sense? I mean, that's not...
Yes, definitely.
Might be a bit abstract, but...
No,
it's a great question.
Sense. Thank you.
I'm glad you're reading Bonhoeffer. That's fantastic. Oh!
Well, that worked.
Yeah.
Okay, well, let me first thank you so much.
You're welcome.
I'm from the Bible Belt down in the South. So down there, the Southern Baptist Convention is a big influence. So our church has had Albert Miller over to speak. And the theological vision they cast for the church, which is hoping to address postmodernism, is that, you know, with the rise of birth control, families were destroyed, and this was taking place in a time where the church was encouraging morality, and it was kind of an empty shell, where there was nothing really at the center of it. So, you know, I think our churches in our area have been encouraged to try to focus on truth, maybe more logic, to combat the stirrings of postmodernity. And what I find so fascinating is that you talk about how the people who read Augustine from a philosophical standpoint ignore the incarnation. which is essentially the logos, the word, the reason becoming flesh. Mm-hmm. So kind of a combination of those things. Mm-hmm. So do you see the solution as kind of more of a balance between looking at truth and finding and looking at relationship, or do we need to more emphasize the relationship aspect? So essentially, how should the church address this?
Yeah. It's an interesting question. So I don't, I have this certain allergy to the word balance. So I feel like, do you know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. because it's like a little bit of truth and a little bit of relationship. No. I want both. I think what interests me is that someone like Augustine, who is so forthrightly Christian, obviously, I mean, like he's like over the top Christian, and yet he gets picked up by these kind of atheistic French philosophers. And engaged philosophically. And so what interested me is, what are the parts that they filter out, right? And in a way, what you get in 20th century philosophy is Augustinian diagnosis without Augustinian prescription. And what I'm suggesting is, but it's the prescription that really is the unique insight. I also think, though, it's interesting, I sometimes think even as Christian philosophers, we have a little bit of a tendency to sort of appropriate what we think will be believable in the philosophical community at large, which then makes us kind of ratchet down some of the specificities of cross and resurrection and incarnation and ascension. And what I'm suggesting is, I wonder if actually, though, we might better serve our wider philosophical neighbors and conversation partners, mm-hmm. and actually the world, if we actually also philosophically talked from the specificity of Christian faith. And I guess I think that that's true. You started with more cultural, socio-political examples of that. Mm-hmm. I actually think the best way that we can sort of leaven society, however you might want to talk mm-hmm. about that, is to actually be more forthrightly and robustly the church and Christian and bear witness to how to be human in that sense, in a way that a wider culture looks around and says, we forgot how to do that. I really do think we're reaching a moment in which in late modern liberalism, people kind of don't know how to be human anymore. And if the church has a calling, it's to be an outpost that shows what it looks like to be human and communal. And I think that's a high calling. Yeah.
Yeah, well, thank you so much.
You're welcome. Great.
So going back to chapel this morning, practically, yeah. how do we go about retraining ourselves with new liturgies that point us back to God?
Chapel tomorrow morning.
Okay.
Answer to that question. No, so I'm not, I don't want to, the chaplain's all over this. But yeah, so what I want to do tomorrow morning and into Friday is now reframe for us. It builds back to a little bit to the earlier question. Look, I'm trying to make the case of why you should commit yourself to the church. I know that's a very uncouth sort of argument to make, but I want to reframe it by saying it's in the body of Christ that you are actually invited into sort of love-shaping, love-reforming practices that bring you into the story that Augustine is inviting you into. So what I want to talk about is why some of the concrete practices of the church's confession, baptism, the Lord's table are actually like they carry the story of the gospel in a way that it seeps down into your bones. So it's not anything novel. I'm actually just I'm pointing back to ancient practices as sort of exactly what we need in a contemporary context.
Okay. Yeah. Thank
Does that
you.
Work?
Yeah.
So I'll hope to see you in the morning. Great. Yes, ma'am.
First of all, thank you so much.
I
if I'm not mistaken, you said something about the only way we'll be able to get through our angst is when we begin to see it as an avenue to worship. And I'm wondering if you could talk more about the connection between malaise and worship.
Yeah, so sorry, I probably rushed through that. If you think of our sort of the condition that we're trying to analyze as this malaise that we're talking about, I think it makes a difference if you realize that in many ways it is the fruit of disordered worship. So that I think at the heart of Augustine's picture is that, yes, human beings are made to be lovers and to love God. That is again synonymous with saying that human beings are worshipers who are made to worship God. And in a way, the malaise and angst and frustration and sort of fragmentation and disappointments that characterize late modern life are precisely because we're worshiping the wrong things, right? So to be human, you can't not worship. It's not a question of whether you worship, it's a question of what. And I think the diagnosis here should be we're worshiping the wrong things. We're worshiping gods that can never return to us what we're looking for, and therefore the way out of the malaise is also liturgical, so to speak, right? The way out of the malaise is to worship something that is actually worth your love, right? That has worth-ship, that should draw, the beautiful picture that you see in Augustine, you see this in Gregory of Nyssa too, right? Is God is this being whom you can never plumb the depths of, right? You can keep loving and worshiping infinitely and always be discovering new things about him and encountering new things. And so that's why it'd be interesting when someone like David Foster Wallace, who doesn't really have a Christian framework, says the same thing. It's like, oh, yeah, this is a matter of worship. Does that?
It does. Do you mind if I ask another
question? No, please.
Okay, so I feel like so much of artistic expression comes out of that sense of angst and malaise. So where does that leave the artist if they replace the disordered worship with the more ordered affections?
Say a little bit more about the artist piece. So do you mean how would their art look different?
No, or? I think that, or at least personally I've experienced that sometimes the artist's muse is their malaise and their angst.
Oh, yeah. No, that's very good. So if you achieved peace, you could no longer create, right? That's kind of the worry. I mean, part of me, I totally know what you're talking about, but part of me feels like I also, we ought to push back on the assumption that you need melancholy, malaise, and disorder in order to create art that's worth engaging. Because if that were the case, then actually art would cease to be in the kingdom. And I don't think that's true, right? Mm-hmm. So there must be other spaces and tensions or depths that the arts can come out of. By the way, I should say as an oral footnote, I think the arts become a huge player in the whole picture that we're painting here in this Augustinian sort of universe, because it's precisely an appeal to the imagination that we're working on here, right? It's not just an Augustine, the Confessions is not a list of syllogisms. It's a literary, it's like a novel. It functions like a novel, right? Drama, tension, character, his poetry, all of, it's an artistic work that functions aesthetically, and I think that's crucial to the whole project in a sense. Yeah. Okay. Great question. Sorry I didn't answer it very well.
No, it's fine. Thank you so much.
You bet.
Can you talk more about the use of the word Uzziah and its significance?
Yeah, so, and this is I'm admittedly being probably a little playful and over-reading, but so there's just this cool thing. Augustine comes to the parable of the prodigal son. And he sees, by the way, one of the things Augustine doesn't see is a story about Israel, which is a problem, because, I mean, it's clearly about Israel, too. So, but what Augustine sees is a parable of the human drama, right, the human condition. And so when the son comes to the father and says, I want my inheritance, my property, the Greek word there is ousia. Now, we know Augustine hated Greek, but he knew enough to know that ousia is this, like, really central philosophical term in Plato and Aristotle about property and substance and being. And so when the son, who's the creature, comes to the father, who's the creator, and says, give me my being, and I want to do with it what I want, Augustine hears in that a kind of philosophical drama that's unfolding. And it's the parallel of us taking the gift of human existence, the gift of creaturely existence, and then spending it in the ways that we want rather than in the ways that the Father desires us to see it spent. That, by the way, turns out to be for our own good. So it's that one use of the Greek term in Luke 15 that then sort of spills off of that. Yeah. Jean-Luc Marion, by the way, one of the French philosophers I mentioned, spins the story out a little bit. Sorry, Emmanuel.
I was just going to bring up Jean-Luc. What would you say that the French postmoderns, Christian or non-Christian, add to Augustine? We were thinking about it when you're talking about he reads Plato and he says, he's got this, but he's missing this. And then you kind of seem to say that the French postmoderns read Augustine, they got this, but they didn't take it that next step, further.
Yeah, they didn't take the incarnation. They didn't take his specifically gospeled elements, so to speak, right?
Would you say that there have been some that have gotten there?
Jean-Luc Marion is probably the exception to this whole, if you take Martin Heidegger, Albert Camus, Jacques Derrida, Jean-François Lyotard, and then Jean-Luc Marion is the most contemporary reader of Augustine across this tradition. Marion is also the one who is most forthrightly Christian in the project. Well, the only one that's forthrightly Christian in that project. And so he's kind of attuned. So I should, to be fair, grace and gift is all over his project. I'm thinking of these more influential appropriations that were sort of scaled Augustine down to something that they could get without having to deal with the scandal of grace, in a sense.
In that still, did they add anything to him? What would be the benefit of a postmodern reading of Augustine?
That's a great question. My sense is what you would get from reading Augustine through them is I think it will wake you up to existential dynamics going on in the confessions that you might miss otherwise. So in other words, I totally, totally believe that it is a hermeneutical opening to read Heidegger and then read the confessions, because I think you'll see the confessions in a way you hadn't seen it before. I don't necessarily, that's maybe not quite the same as adding anything, but it definitely opens something. And that's actually kind of my own story of encountering Augustine. I felt like I read Augustine when I was in college, and I read him kind of like a scholastic, to be honest, right? And I read him as, sometimes philosophers are particularly prone to basically just pull out, you know, we read Book 11 and things. Whereas then I read Heidegger, and I found out this kind of backstory, and then you go back. I should also say, I feel like I've done an injustice. Hannah Arendt's book, Love and St. Augustine, her dissertation, is probably the most eye-popping entree back into Augustine, and in many ways I've still been living off of that book. So I think what they add is this hermeneutic opening, because otherwise I've always been puzzled now at people who have these caricatures of Augustine, like all he's like got this all these hang-ups about sex and all, and I'm like, I don't recognize that Augustine anymore. It's some sort of caricatured Augustine. Yeah.
Thank you.
Great question.
Hey. I'm not a student here. I just just some bum off the street.
Yeah,
I'm like,
great.
Oh, hey, yeah.
Great.
I feel in some ways, and I love your work, and I really appreciate everything. It's been hugely formative for me. I feel in some ways I kind of am evangelizing to my analytic friends about this kind of stuff, right? Like, not any better or worse, but it's like this. It's like a different language, right? We approach it differently. And what is your kind of recommendation for me as I talk about cultural liturgies and formation and in some ways a more embodied Christianity, right? Yeah. Like the body is an important component in our formative, what way can I discuss this with my more analytic friend? How have you kind of gone about that in your...
Yeah.
I know this is kind of an enormous question,
I work in a department that is predominantly analytic.
I was going to say, Alvin Plantinga, who's been hugely influential in my life as well. He's a wonderful,
Wonderful. So I think what I do is I look for the overlapping points of So I don't think analytic philosophy is a monolithic thing. Do you know what I mean? So I have my colleague Kevin Corcoran, who does work on embodiment, soul, personality kinds of things. And what I see in his, here analytic is more vibe than school, right? Or sort of thing.
Sure.
And what I see in him is actually a lot of interest in embodiment themes and stuff like that. So we've looked for points of contact between the phenomenological tradition of, say, Merleau-Ponty and his very different universe of discourse, but nonetheless has brought him to the same points. And so we look And I would say, by the way, it's precisely because we both have Christian concerns that we're looking for these points of overlap and contact. Interesting, I just taught Plantinga again last semester. And what's interesting, if you go especially to early Alvin Plantinga, there are so many interesting social features to his epistemology that I feel like drop out later on in his thought, or at least drop out the way people have appropriated his thought. So if you go back to Reason and Belief in God, the essay, you'll see that he's like really attentive to almost like the ecclesiology of Christian understanding and knowledge. So I what I'm doing is I just look for levers that I can pull sympathetically within those traditions. And I know analytic colleagues who are doing the same thing, trying to build the bridge over to jargon-laden continental philosophy.
Yeah, exactly. I hope that happens more soon than not, you know, because I think there's a lot of strength here. I was going to just mention that Reformed epistemology, I feel like, has this openness to kind of the, you know, the project of, you know, continental, and I brought this up to some friends, and I don't know, they definitely, like, just rejected it outhand, because, like you said, there's sort of an appropriation of his work in a way. Yep. Where when I read like Derrida and like I see some similar approaches of like kind of deconstructing this modern epistemology, right? So okay, that
totally.
Was my
And I should add, I do think the sort of recent growth and development of virtue epistemology is a little bit like a third way, or at least it's like a third space where both of those communities can come into a conversation and find overlapping concerns.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah. What was that? It's bounced, yeah. It's Starbucks. It's a third place. Yeah, yeah, that's great. I think we've reached the end of our attention spans. Thanks, everybody.